Good morning, everybody. Mr. Parthasarathy is one of the most respected and well-informed advocate of Madras High Court. He was born in 1957, obtained his degree in science from New College and later law degree from Madras Law College. He got enrolled himself in the year 1983 and was designated as a senior advocate of Madras High Court in the year 2005. Mr. Parthasarathy hails from a family with a rich legacy. His paternal grandfather by name R. Kishamacharya was the Diwan of Pudukote Samasthanam. His maternal grandfather by name Mr. E. V. Srinivasacharya was from Srirangam and was a leading lawyer at Trichy, and he was also a public prosecutor at Trichy. He was a congressman, and later he was very closely associated with Mr. Rajaji in floating the Swandra Party. Mr. S. Parthasarathy was a junior under his own father and a doyen of the Madras High Court by name Mr. K. Sarvabhouman and also Sir T. R. Mani, senior advocates of the Madras High Court, and he gained in-depth knowledge in civil law practice under them. Mr. S. Parthasarathy, known for his legal acumen and his appearances in a number of cases in the Madras High Court, would speak loud of his caliber and mettle. Before his association with Mr. K. Sarvabhouman and Mr. T. R. Mani, Mr. Parthasarathy was associated with Justice K. Ramamurthy of Supreme Court and assisted him for his briefs in before the Supreme Court. Mr. Parthasarathy is a renowned resource person in Tamil Nadu State Judicial Academy and has delivered a lot of guest lectures on various subjects. He is blessed with a musician wife and two lawyers, son and daughter, namely Suhrit and Susarika, and they continue the third generation legacy. And with this warm introduction, may I welcome Shri H. Parthasarathy sir to deliver his lecture on the law of adverse possession. Sir, welcome. The forum is yours.
Thank you, Raghavan, Srinivas Raghavan. So kind of you to have given me such a introduction. Before I commence my lecture, I should congratulate both you and Hemalata, and you have successfully completed 54 webinars, and this is the 55th. See, to begin something is not very difficult. To sustain it is very difficult. And both of you have done it extremely well, and all your lectures have been well received. With that, so we should all thank you. The legal community should thank you for this service.
Oh, please, sir. It's all because of resource person like you and your blessings.
And of course, Justice Anand Venkatesh was the trigger.
Yes, sir.
Now, going into the topic of law of adverse possession. See, possession is a very difficult concept. And to understand possession, one must have a knowledge of what ownership is. In today's lecture, we are going to analyze the law of adverse possession. Before I get into the subject, let us have a bird's eye view of the meaning of ownership. All of you know that property means ownership. In common parlance, the term property is used to signify the thing over which a right of ownership subsists. So juristically, the term property is synonymous with the right of ownership. The most comprehensive or supreme right that can be exercised over anything is ownership. For instance, when we say A is the owner of Black Acre is the property of A. So property can be synonymous with ownership. Ownership denotes the relation between a person and the right that is vested in him. where a man owns a right which is vested in him, he becomes the owner of the property. And ownership is a right which avails against the world. It's a jus in rem. And it is a determinate thing, indefinite in point of user, unrestricted in point of disposition, and unlimited in point of duration. So the first characteristic of ownership is that it is indefinite in point of user. That is, the object of ownership may be used in a way without injuring the rights of other persons. So he becomes an independent entity who is enjoying the property that is owned by him. The second characteristic of ownership is that it is unrestricted in point of disposition. See, once you are the owner for life, unless you don't want to be the owner. That is, you can transfer the ownership by way of any instrument which not only takes effect during his lifetime, that is by a transfer inter vivos, or by a testamentary device, you can transfer after your life. So this is another important characteristic. So right of alienation is a necessary ingredient of ownership. Ownership is an unfettered and a free right of disposition. As I told you, it is unlimited in point of duration. It exists as long as the property exists. And again, it is a heritable right. See, the ownership will pass on to the next of kin as per the succession laws of the individual. So therefore, ownership is a concept which is wide and extends to all classes of rights, whether proprietary or personal. In fact, a person may own a debt, that is, or a mortgage, or a share in a company, or a money in public funds, or a copyright, or a lease, or a right of way, and also absolute interest in land. So in this sense, every man is the owner of the right that is inhering in him in respect of the property, whatever may be the property. So the reason why I have commenced this lecture by delineating the concept of ownership is because we are going to discuss prescription of title by adverse possession. So we have to understand the concept of ownership, which is opposed to possession. Possession is a very, very difficult concept, and possession of right is the de facto relation of a continuing exercise of enjoyment. Whereas ownership is a de jure relationship. A man may possess a right without owning it, or he may own a right without possessing it. Ownership and possession may be united when de facto and de jure unifies in the same person. So concept of ownership is a right in him, or the right itself is vested in him. That is, the owner of right is it in whom the right itself is vested, while the encumbrancer of it, supposing if not the right itself, but some adverse, dominant, and limiting right. I will see, it's a very simple thing. I will explain how it is. A may be the owner of the property, B the lessee of it, C the sublessee, D the first mortgagee, E the second mortgagee, and so on indefinitely. The same property. A may be the owner, B may be the lessee, C may be the sublessee, and the property may be mortgaged there will be a first mortgagee, that is D, and there will be a second mortgage, that is E. So these things can happen with reference to the property. Supposing the, as far as the encumbrancer is concerned, you saw A may be the owner of the property, but B is the owner of the lease. C is the owner of the sublease. D, the owner of the first mortgage. E, the second mortgage. These are all concepts of ownership, but what is the limit of their ownership? So that is, so ownership is a concept which brings about a legal relationship. It is something, you see, ownership is a purely a right which is created in law. But possession is purely in the sphere of facts. So therefore, on the basis of now, let us see how possession as a concept has developed. And as you know, few relationships are as vital to man as that of possession. You see, that is the reason why every system of law, whether it is primitive or developed, provides rules for its protection. If you, for instance, even if you take our law, Specific Relief Act, you have Section 5 of the Specific Relief Act and Section 6 of the Specific Relief Act. Even a person who is in illegal possession of a property, the owner cannot take the right in his own hands and dispossess the possessor. So he gets a remedy under Section 6. So possession, that's what they say, they used to say possession is 9.6. So the essential difference is possession differs from ownership. Ownership consists of a combination of legal rights. Some or all may be present at the same time. So as I said, ownership implies the existence of legal rules under a system of law. See, for instance, you have the Transfer of Property Act. It deals with how ownership in a property can be transferred. So with reference to, supposing if it is a sale, you will have to comply with the requirements of Transfer of Property Act. Similarly, with reference to gift, with reference to mortgage, with reference to lease, even with reference to actionable claims. So you can also own a debt. So these are all, so the ownership is something which is, and you have to also satisfy the requirements of Registration Act. So these are all legal rules which have been framed to create ownership. But as far as possession is concerned, even without this legal relationship, one can be in possession and he can possess the property. That becomes a question of fact. So purely a pure question of fact will have to be decided as to who is in possession. And so therefore, and that's the reason why they say possession is a relationship between the person and the thing that he is in possession of. See, and in fact, there can be possession without ownership, ownership without possession, and also properties which are incapable of being possessed. So therefore, in law, possession is a good title against anyone who cannot show a better title or a better right. And in fact, a person who is in wrongful possession has the rights of an owner with respect to the property against everyone except the rightful owner. For instance, That is the reason why you will have to look into section 110 of the Evidence Act. The principle is what is the principle with reference to possession, that it is as it is derived only from section 110 of the Evidence Act. What is section 110? Person who is in possession is supposed to be the person who has title to the property unless the person who seeks to dispossess shows a better right, and he can maintain his possession against everyone except the true owner. So possession as a concept in law is something which is very important, and therefore that is the reason why they say, because possession is good title against all. That is the reason they say possession is a very 9 points in law. And in fact, even a wrongdoer who is in possession can be deprived of his possession only by due process of law. In fact, the true owner who trespasses, who comes into possession of, re-enters the property without any legal recourse, by taking law into his own hands, the person in possession can bring a suit and it drive the owner for a regular proceeding to recover possession as per law. So unless there is a judgment in accordance with law, the possessor cannot be dispossessed. So now, having given a background as to what is possession, let us go into concept of adverse possession. Adverse possession is a right in property acquired by prescription. See, adverse possession is a concept which is not new. If you, the latest judgment of Justice Arun Mishra's judgment, if you read just paragraph 3 of the judgment, that is 2019 volume 8 SCC, page 729, Ravinder Kaur Gravial versus Manjit Kaur. And this is how the learned, the three-member bench, while overruling the earlier judgment, have dealt with the aspect. And in para 3, they have clearly delineated how the adverse possession developed. And so therefore, it is not something which is new to India. It is there in Australia, it is there in London. London, it is 20 years. So everywhere, possession is protected. And you see, it has been said that with reference to adverse possession, there is no equity. But we don't have to go into the equitable concepts, because now the law is very well settled. We have a definite limitation act, section 27 of the Limitation Act, read with article 64 and 65 of the Limitation Act. Clearly, not only bars the remedy, but also gives a right. You'd be surprised that section 27 gives a right. Section 27 of the Limitation Act, I will read it out to you. At the determination of the period hereby limited to any person for instituting a suit for possession of any property, his right to such property shall be extinguished. And what is the limitation for that? For that, you have to see Article 64 and 65. So a right is given now under Section 27 of the Limitation Act. You can acquire a title by adverse possession. Adverse possession means possession by a person other than the true owner, and such possession is hostile under a claim or color of title, actual, open, notorious, and continuous, exclusive. See, that as far as adverse possession is concerned, it need not be concealed. And it is also not necessary that it should be made known to the true owner. It is enough if it is open and hostile. Concept of adverse possession takes notes of two things: corpus possidendi and animus possidendi. Corpus possidendi is the physical possession, and animus possidendi is the intention to hold the property with the mental element that he is holding it adversely to the true owner without any attempt at concealment. And no possession can be adverse without this animus. So it's the possession to be adverse, and adverse is that possession, in order to be adverse, must be hostile to the true owner. So the animus to prescribe must be there. Without the intention to acquire property by adverse possession, there can be no adverse possession or acquisition of title by prescription. So just possession is not enough to give title. Even a continuous long possession is not sufficient to give title. See, it is wrong to assume that merely because you are in possession for over 12 years, you have prescribed title. There are certain ingredients which are necessary to be proved, like the animus. Unless you have the animus, the law does not say that you become the owner. I will take you through Article 64 and 65, then you will get the picture. You see, it is generally felt that adverse possession is a very bad concept, but there is a very noble and a public policy involved behind the concept of adverse possession. It serves a very beneficial public purpose. You see, to prevent the taking away from one what he has been long permitted to enjoy and consider his own, and on the faith of such possession, he has arranged his life, habits, and expenses. So, see, if the owner does not care less, he has allowed somebody to enjoy without asserting his right within the time allowed, then he has to fail. Because previous, the entire basis for this is a land or something should not be allowed uncultivated for long. If somebody is enjoying the property to the benefit of all, his rights should be protected. So that is the reason why even in other countries, they still have this law of adverse possession. But that doesn't mean that the law of limitation is intended to give right where there is none. But to impose a bar after a certain period to enforce the existing right. See, normally, Limitation Act only bars the remedy. But if you look at Section 27, it does not only bar the remedy, but it also gives an indefeasible right. Normally, the remedy alone is not barred. Even the right is taken away. What I mean by that is the right is extinguished at the determination of the period fixed as per Article 64 and Article 65 of the Limitation Act. These two articles were respectively Article 142 and 144 of the 1908 Act. And the 1908 Act was substantially changed in 1963. And in fact, there was a very subtle modification to the law. Subtle modification to the law in 1963. And as far as Article 64 is concerned, or Article 6, which was Article 65 is concerned, Article 144 of the old Act prescribed that not only should a plaintiff prove his possession, but also show that he was in possession at least at some point of time prior to 12 years from the date of institution of the suit. That requirement is no longer there. It is enough if the plaintiff proves his title. It is for the defendant to prove how he has prescribed his title by adverse possession. So the burden is on the defendant. And as far as Article 64 is concerned, again, it is an article which speaks of suits for possession based on previous possession. Again, person who has been in previous possession can bring a suit, and for that he has to show that he has been in enjoyment of the property and the defendant had not enjoyed the property for more than 12 years. See, he may be even a person without title. See, this position in Article 64, I will give you an illustration. A brought a suit against his brother B in respect of a house property, alleging that the house belonged to him and he had permitted the defendant to occupy the same without any rent. That is, he allowed his brother to be in permissive occupation and did not, but despite the fact that he wanted the property back, his brother has refused. With the result, he had to come to court to get a decree for possession. But the brother B denied A's title and set up his own title and also pleaded adverse possession for more than 12 years before the suit. Now, A failed to prove a license or that he was in possession prior to 12 years before the suit. Therefore, on the facts, Article 64 of the Limitation Act got attracted as he was not in a position to prove. Supposing if he had proved his title, then B has to give possession if he is not in adverse possession. But with reference to the requirement, supposing if he had proved possession prior to 12 years, then he should be put back in possession, even if he is not the owner. Even that he was not in a position to prove. So therefore, A would not succeed in the. So now, coming to the concept of Section 27, Article 64, and Article 65. As far as Section 27 of the Limitation Act is concerned, if the person having the right to possession suffers his right to be barred by the law of limitation, his title itself is extinguished in favor of the party in possession. Under Article 65 of the Limitation Act, the period for filing a suit to recover possession based on title is 12 years. When possession of the defendant becomes adverse to the plaintiff. As I told you, mere expiry of 12 years will not extinguish title. The possession from the beginning should be adverse to the true owner. And you would have all of you would have come across this concept of nec qui, nec clam, and nec precario. Without force, without secrecy, without permission. So this is the requirement of adverse possession. The possession must be without force. It should not be concealed, that is without secrecy. And it should not be permissive. You see, that's why they say that a person who comes into possession under part performance under Section 53 capital A of the Transfer of Property Act, is at best, he is a permissive occupant. He cannot prescribe title to the property by adverse possession. So, person who comes into possession on a permission as a licensee cannot suddenly claim that he is in adverse possession unless he is in a position to show that he discharged the license and from such and such a date to the knowledge of the defendant he had disputed his permission and he has been in possession. And again, what the reason why they say is adverse possession is frowned upon is because of this principle. They say that possession must be commenced in the wrong and maintained against the right. A possession which is commenced in the wrong, so you're recognizing a person who has commenced his possession in the wrong and he has maintained that possession against the right. So therefore, to some of the jurists, this principle of adverse possession, and in fact, Justice Dalveer Bhandari also asked for scrapping of Article 64 and said this principle of adverse possession. And in fact, adverse possession definition you will not find either in Section 27 or in the Limitation Act or in Article 64 or Article 65. It's again a judgment law and from the concept of what interest a person is, the animus. So everybody, all the decided cases went on the principle of animus possidendi to come to a conclusion regarding adverse possession. Because there is no ready-made definition under the Act. It does not say hostile. All these things are all judgment, right from Privy Council judgments. And in fact, to some extent, you can say Section 27 clearly says that your right is extinguished. How the right is extinguished? Not by mere possession of 12 years, but by showing that you have prescribed your title by having the necessary animus to remain in possession as the owner in denial of the title of the true owner. Now, the pursuant to the advent of Section 27 of the Limitation Act, divergent views were expressed by the courts whether a person who has prescribed his title by adverse possession can bring an independent suit seeking declaration of his title on the basis of adverse possession, or he can only defend his possession on the ground of adverse possession. Of course, the two-member bench in Gurudwara Sahib, 2014 1 SEC 669, held that no such declaratory relief can be granted. Such a suit is not maintainable. But this judgment came to be overruled in 2019. That was the judgment I referred to. Ravinder Kaur versus Grewal. Ravinder Kaur Grewal versus Manjit Kaur. 2019 8 SEC 729. I think I don't think it is really necessary to give up. But if you read that judgment, the entire law relating to adverse possession is completed. Everything, all the judgments have been digested. Everything is there in that one judgment, 2019-8 SEC 729. It is enough if you refer to that judgment to know what exactly is the concept of adverse possession. You see, this illustration will explain Section 27 of the Limitation Act. For instance, if a right to sue for redemption of mortgage is extinguished by lapse of time and the mortgagee cannot sue for possession, that being the position, the mortgagee can bring a suit that the mortgage having extinguished by lapse of time, having not been redeemed, they had become full owners. And such a relief is available under Section 27 of the Limitation Act. Mortgages become owners of the property. And here there is no question of any equity to be decided because you have the law in Section 27 of the Limitation Act. Once the law intervenes, there is no equity. And as far as since the owner loses the right of redemption, nothing inheres in him to resist. See, the right of redemption is the ownership in him that had vested in him, that he had lost. So once the right of redemption goes, then he also loses his title to the property. Okay. You see, supposing if he's not able to redeem the mortgage, can he bring a suit for possession? He cannot. Therefore, it is the provision under section 27 is an exception to the rule that limitation is a statute of recourse and ordinarily bars a remedy, but does not extinguish a right. Such an extinction of remedy as contemplated by the provisions of the Limitation Act, prima facie would be attracted in all types of suits relating to possession. And now we have to see what is the effect of break in adverse possession. Acquisition of titles by prescription requires adverse possession for the full statutory period. Such possession has to be actual, since law does not recognize constructive possession in favor of trespassers. The decision reported in Lakshmi Reddy versus L. Lakshmi Reddy, AR 1957 Supreme Court 314, where there is disruption on account of anything, there is no question of continuance of adverse possession. The possession held previous to the break will be totally wiped off. So that's why the possession should be continuous. Break in the continuity of adverse possession may result from so many ways. It can result by an act of God, voluntary abandonment, inconsistent conduct of the intruder, then interference even by the rightful owner, and decree of court. Anything can bring about a disruption in the adverse possession. But a stray act will not be disruption, but it has to be an actual act of dispossession to bring about a break in adverse possession. And of course, the person, the adverse possessor, or the person who had not come, can also abandon and relinquish the property in favor of the, then the property revests in the owner, and no act is necessary on his part to bring about such revesting. You don't require a limitation ceases to run against the true owner on the break or continuity of possession. And in fact, within the statutory period, if the owner is able to make a rightful re-entry, then adverse possession comes to an end. Or rather, the possession is interrupted, not resulting in continuous possession for over 12 years. Now, as far as this is with reference to proper persons who are in possession against individuals, third parties, but the concept of there is no concept of adverse possession as between co-owners, as between persons who are joint owners, for instance, like co-partners or co-owners who are entitled to jointly own the property. One co-owner, by remaining in possession, cannot prescribe title to the property, because the concept of co-ownership is based on unity of title and unity of possession. One co-owner is presumed to be in law, is in possession on behalf of all the co-owners. So therefore, one co-owner to prescribe title in a regular independent title, there is something more which he has to establish, not just open, hostile, continuous. But he has to prove that he has been in possession of the property adversely to the knowledge, of the co-owner. You see, as far as adverse possession is concerned, he doesn't have to conceal. But as far as that concept is known as ooster, you will come across. See, the adverse possession between co-owners is called as ouster or ooster. This ooster is the principle by which one co-owner woos the other co-owner and prescribes title to property on his own. So the for purpose of ooster, there has to be plea in the plaint or the defend or in the written statement contending that I have prescribed my title on account of ooster. Clear details and particulars of the ooster should be given. There must be a clear plea. It's not just mere question of law which can be raised. And on the basis of that plea, you have to let in evidence that to the knowledge of the other person, I have been in possession in my own right. He has been deprived of not only the income, he has been also deprived of anything that is in the property. And he knows. So this knowledge aspect will have to be established in evidence. For the purpose of ooster, you can refer to, of course, again, I already said the classical judgment is AR 1957 Supreme Court 314, AR 1999 Supreme Court 2633, AR 1996 Supreme Court 1724. So if there is no ooster or exclusion, the possession of one co-owner is not adverse to the others. So ouster is the exclusion of other co-heir to their knowledge and intention and conduct by the co-owner who is in possession. And he claims title on the basis of adverse possession. Must be something more than the requirement of adverse possession between strangers. You may also refer to AR 1972 Madras 467, an erudite classical judgment by my senior Justice K.S. Ramamurthy. The entire principle of ouster is beautifully delineated in Ibrasa Rauter vs. Sheikh Mirasa. 1972 Madras 467 equivalent to 1972 1MLJ 466. See, in this division bench judgment, it was an ordinary partition suit between Mohammedan Muslims. And the one of the contentions that is raised is that there was a prior partition and at a family arrangement, these lands were allotted. And having regard to the fact that the plaintiff was not in a position to establish that because for a very long number of years, plaintiff was out of possession. And from that, a presumption of lost grant was made, and it was held that the plaintiff had been ousted and he has no right to property. He has no right of share. So there was a presumption of lost grant was enunciated in that judgment also. Now again, with reference to persons getting into possession under invalid transaction, the possession is adverse from the date of the invalid transaction. Where a person takes possession of property under a color of transfer, which is inoperative, such possession is adverse to the true owner from the date of the possession. AR 1951 Supreme Court 469, AR 1970 Supreme Court 1778. The reason behind this is the transferee gets no title under the transfer, and his possession is therefore without title and in contravention of the title of the true owner. Possession of settlee under an invalid settlement deed is adverse from the date of the invalid document. Similarly, possession of a purchaser under an invalid sale is adverse as against the vendor from the date of sale. Now, with reference to evidence of adverse possession, it must be remembered that acts sufficient to constitute possession on the owner may not be sufficient to constitute possession in the trespasser. For instance, in a suit for bare injunction, possession on the date of suit is sufficient. Possession on the date of suit is sufficient in a suit for bare injunction. Evidence proving such possession on the, whereas to claim title on the basis of adverse possession, there must be some evidence to show such possession is notorious, exclusive, and hostile. So what is the evidence here? As far as suit for bare injunction, it is enough if you show that you have been in possession on the date of the suit. But if you want to claim a title on the basis of adverse possession, you will have to show possession for over 12 years in open, hostile, open, hostile, and continuous. AR 1938 Madras 454 Division Bench. And a claim based on adverse possession requires clear and categorical pleadings and evidence. The date from which such possession became adverse has to be established, has to be, before establishing, you have to plead. AR 1997 Supreme Court 381. And a person, and AR 1996 Supreme Court 869. AR 2011 Supreme Court 1480. So this is the bare concept of adverse possession, which you will come across in the, in our life, in our life in court on this. So in conclusion, the concept of adverse possession, one need not feel that it is bad. For the reason, you see, the person who has not cared for his property and somebody else has arranged his entire life on the basis of that property cannot be made to lose his possession, and therefore it is, there is some purpose and object behind Section 27 of the Limitation Act. In fact, that is the reason why to gain title by adverse possession has been made difficult. It is not very easy. So with that, I conclude my lecture. If any questions, we can have an interactive session.
Mr. Prabhakar, sir.
The question is with regard to the concept of adverse possession against an idol. Can an idol be held a minor under the Limitation Act? The judgment of the Babri Masjid case, which clarified the issue, hitherto we were all having a doubt after 1971 Supreme Court that the idol being a minor, the question of perfecting title against the idol doesn't arise. Now, in the Babri Masjid case, the five judges have felt that the idol is not a minor insofar as Limitation Act is concerned. What is your view on that, sir?
As far as Tamil Nadu is concerned, we have 109.
Before 30th September 1951,
sir. Under the present act, even 1951 is gone.
It has gone. If somebody has perfected title before 30th September 1951,
That was the previous law, Prabhakar.
Yes, sir.
Now the recent section 109 does not give any length of time.
if already the right is vested before
adu vara ellave ellave poiiduthu ipo just see 109
how about the judgment of Starship Tarun Chatterjee sir reported in AIR 2009 Supreme Court where he said that a right vested as you have cited the article 27 a right which has extinguished under the old law cannot be revived
it's a special enactment that's 109 is there that's how it is
the second question is 109 speaks about a suit for possession suppose the religious institution files a suit for declaration whether still 109 gets attracted
what kind of declaration yes even any type of suit
it says only 109 says in a suit for possession
mere declaration without possession nobody is going to ask see they are not just going to ask declaration there is going to be another relief of possession or injunction whatever it is injunction they have to prove their possession if they are not going to prove their possession their suit is going to be dismissed for not asking for an appropriate relief so the declaration of title declaration of any right will have to be with reference to some other further relief it cannot be just a mere declaration unless if it is a declaration of a status look at 109 of the HRNC act now the amendment was 2003 nothing contained in limitation act 1963 shall apply to any suit for possession of immovable property belonging to any religious institution or for possession of any interest so section 27 is also taken away nothing contained in the limitation act is so section 27 of the limitation act also goes there is no question of and it does not say prior to 1951
so there is one question in the chat box
yeah
that has a doubt regarding the court fee payable in case of a suit for title on the basis of prescription by adverse possession
there nothing like that you are again only claiming title
exactly it makes no difference whether it is by adverse possession or by a document or something my question sir is very simple why Justice Dalveer Bhandari in our high court Justice Selvam they were opposed to the doctrine of adverse possession
in fact if you read that judgment where they said that it was not now even before the Christian era such a law was there
oh
not just a recent even the Hammurabi's code as in fact Hammurabi's code only 3 years
only 3 years we are better
and again it is where is the question of no equities in the case of adverse possession it is already a statutory law now section 27
of the limitation
so there is the question of there are no equities in favor of adverse possession you can't even bring in equity unless you are if you're able to satisfy section 27 along with article 64 and 65 as the case may be then you are entitled to have your title declared you can either resist or even go to court supposing if your right is threatened
yes sir but the pity in some of the pleadings you could have find that while the plaintiff traces title through a document of sale or something you can also find a paragraph at the before the corporation stated
even otherwise I have prescribed title
yes sir I don't know how it goes together is it not mutually destructive to each other
in fact you are not supposed to plead title
if you want adverse possession
or an adverse possession in fact the judgment are there where you will have to elect between title and adverse possession
but it can be an inconsistent plea in the written state
see again inconsistent plea if you are going to base it on you will have difficulty in proving animus
yes sir I understand but in case if it is pleaded in the written statement as inconsistent plea or something would you like to say it is mutually destructive
mutually destructive in my view it will be mutually destructive because see you have to say that for you have to admit he is the owner and I am in possession adverse to his interest unless you admit his ownership, you cannot claim adverse possession. It can be in denial, but not denial of title, but denial of his right.
Mr. Anand Shivakumar?
Sir, in one of our property, we hold this property for the past 70 years in one of our village, along with other properties, that agricultural land. But basically, those days, they used to call those lands as custom solwa. அது வந்து எங்க லேண்டுக்குள்ள வந்து வந்துருச்சு. ஸோ ஃபார் த பாஸ்ட் 70 இயர்ஸ் இட் இஸ் சார். ஸோ ரீசென்ட்லி வாட் யூ ஹவ் டன் இஸ் வென் யூ அப்ளை டு த லோக்கல் தாசில்தார் டு கெட் அ பட்டா யூ ஹேவ் டினைட் பட் தே சே டு கண்டினியூ த வாட் எவர் பொசிஷன் வித் அஸ்
தே காண்ட் கிவ் யூ பட்டா பிகாஸ் இட் வில் பி எ வேஸ்ட் லேண்ட்
இட்ஸ் எ வேஸ்ட் லேண்ட்
ஃபார் மோக் லேண்ட்
கரெக்ட் வாஸ்து தெரியல சார் எனக்கு
கொடுக்கலனா உங்களுக்கு நல்ல கேஸ் அதுக்காக
கேட்டா கொடுத்து அவர் கேஸ் போச்சு அவ்வளவுதான்
ஆல்மோஸ்ட் வந்து தாத்தா காலத்துல இருந்து இருக்கிறது அது நம்ம தான் இருக்கோம் along with the land it has come those days when they have taken it
as long as they don't disturb continue sir
no disturbance at all sir so far what I tried was like to get a patta recently ava vandu
yeah you can't get sir
fine sir so position pottu varaikum disturbance varadhu future la
varu you can always ungalku section 27 help on
okay sir thank you so much sir
you see article 120 than a part you are saying your possession in 70 years
yes sir
as against government it is only 30 years
yes.
So you are more than 30 years
thank you so much sir
so I'm Raghumaram sir
my query was not on the plaintiff's court fee what I wanted to discuss was
counterclaim
suppose there is a suit for title and possession which is defended by a party who wants to let us say take inconsistent plea or even a uniform plea of adverse possession now earlier you see he was not required to pay
yes by virtue of the recent amendment
yes
justice Sampath has said that if you are going to plead adverse possession you will have to pay court fee
you will have to pay that means
yes.
you are
recent
going
amendment.
To pay
yes
equal amount of court fee as the plaintiff. Who wants possession you see that
yes.
makes the defense itself reasonably yes. difficult you see it makes it illusory if you ask me then who is going to plead adverse possession
that is based on now that's why I said there was a see the law of adverse possession is always looked upon as something which is should not be there so therefore it is yes I remember the recent amendment to the court fees act
yeah
justice Sampath yes. said that court fee will if you are claiming adverse possession you will have to pay court fee
see the thing is
because that is because Raghu you are also claiming title you are trying to defeat somebody's title and by virtue of the dismissal of the suit you are getting title to the property
no I am getting title to the property by virtue of the statute not because the plaintiff chose to sue me
if you are not making any counter claim you don't have to pay court fee
it's only a defense suppose
it's only a defense it is not even a claim that you are making you are just defending your possession on the basis of adverse
Mr. Srinivas Raghu, that was my question.
Yes, sir, I understand, sir. Unless it is made a counterclaim, no question of payment of court fee should arise for consideration. Sir, I have a doubt, sir. Do you require a counterclaim at all to raise the defense of adverse possession?
No. Right? What Raghu's question was, even if you don't raise it as a counterclaim, even
the
if
court fee is supposed to be?
Court fee, you have to pay as per the rules.
That we agree it is not probably in good straight but my question is without there being a counter claim when adverse possession can be pleaded as a matter of right covered by the statute why should we pay the court when it is pleaded as an adverse possession what sir Mr. PVS Giridhar want to ask a question sir
yeah please so far
my question is you were referring to prescriptive right in respect of an easement which is also for 12 years It is a different from adverse possession, no, isn't it?
Easement 20 years.
Yeah, 20 years. So it is different from adverse possession, isn't it?
Definitely, 2 years prior to.
Yeah. So therefore, if I take suppose there is a common pathway and I take a defense that it belongs to me and take an alternative plea that 12 years by 20 years prescriptive right it come to me, that is not mutually destructive, isn't it?
You see.
Yeah.
not mere 20 years. That 20 years should end 2 years prior to the suit. So 22 right. years.
So 22 years.
22 years actually, strictly speaking.
Right, right. Okay, I didn't know that. But I'm asking you, the second question is, if I plead that it belongs to me, I claim title.
All you can't do that.
I've enjoyed it for 20 years.
You see, there is a judgment of justice, Nayanar Sundaram. You can either plead easement or title. Can't do both.
So it's mutually destructive, isn't it?
Mutually destructive.
Oh, I see. Okay. Thank you.
So we have got Mr. Ramesh KP to ask the question.
Sir, as already you told, against the person, adverse possession can be claimed more than 12 years.
Yes.
In case of against the government, adverse possession, 30 years.
Is that
the provision which what article has been discussed, sir?
112
of limitation.
Thank you, Sir Agwa.
I should thank you, sir. It was not a regular classroom atmosphere or a lecture. We felt that as if we were talking with you personally, sitting around you.
Very good.
That kind of atmosphere only we request. It is so for the effort you have taken effortlessly, I should thank for your time and energy, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you all.